In the previous video, we saw the simple way of creating a trend using that data favorites option. And in addition, of course, to building things automatically, you can also build them manually, these trends. So let's take a look at our first dynamic object, the trend. I'll create a brand new display here. Doesn't matter what I name it, it's just going to be a little temporary workspace. On this workspace, I'm going to go ahead and show you the three different ways you can draw a trend. Well, actually, the first way is what we've seen already. Go into Data Favorites, drag and drop, and that is if you've selected trend as the default behavior. So I can go ahead and do that, and that generates a trend for me automatically. In build mode, I can double-click on that, and I can see the builder screen for that if you prefer to just kind of build it automatically and then inspect it later. Now, second way you can do this, let's close the Data Favorites, is there's in the Draw menu, you'll find the Trend option, Draw Trend. And just like all the other objects in Process Book, when you choose Draw Trend, you're going to be presented with an icon. Now you can see it. You can just barely see it. Let me do that again. Draw Trend. And when I move my cursor, it disappears. Yeah, see how that icon changes? The mouse cursor now is showing me a trend object. So that indicates that I'm in trend drawing mode. So I can go ahead and click and drag open a bounding box. That's going to be the ultimately the size of the trend that I create. So I'll go ahead and, in this case, I'll do a quick and dirty trend. I'll just go ahead and draw that bounding box. I'm going to type in the name of a tag. Now in this case, the tag I'm going to use is a tag we use for a lot of testing and training called sinusoid. Just press return and choose OK, and you'll get the default trend behavior. It'll look like that. Now we could have, let me delete that, we could have done it this way, draw trend, and then done a tag search for the tag instead of typing it in by hand. And we've seen the tag search before. You know, simply select the item and then drop it in there. Now, there's another way to do this, and that is with the trend icon. Choosing trend icon is the same thing as choosing draw trend. We just get a different trend. I'm going to start. Let's put in sinusoid. And as you can see, this there are a lot of different attributes that you can configure for the trend. Now, in this class material, we don't attempt to duplicate everything you'll find in the regular manual. So we highly suggest you go out to our PI Process Book User's Guide if you're interested in step-by-step instructions, and go to the Chapter 5, and there you will find instructions on creating a trend. And this goes over in great detail all of the different options available to you, most of which are obvious, so we're not going to talk about it in this class, but we will go over those things that are not so obvious. First of all, of course, you're not limited to a single trace or a single PI tag on a trend. I can type the name of another tag. Let's go with CDT158, or I could do a tag search for that same tag. Let's go out and look for CD. I'll look for CDEP158. Nope, let me go ahead and reset this search. CDE. Yeah, I still had some search criteria from my previous searches. That's why I didn't find that at first. There we go. I can choose that, and as you can see, we're going to deposit that right here. Now, when you've chosen this, three of these trends here, then you have a choice. Do you want single scale or multiple scales? Multiple scales will have a separate y-axis for each one of these trends. This drop-down over here allows you to specify what the format is of the y-axis. So the numbers on the y-axis, as you can see, I can choose two decimal places or give that any of these formats that you see here. You can specify the start time and the end time. And this uses the standard PI syntax. So for example, if this is meant to be yesterday's day shift, I can do something like this, y plus 7 hours to y plus 15 hours. And that will consistently, every time I look at this, give me yesterday's day shift, 7 to 3. Now I'll go ahead and choose some of the defaults here. I'll go with asterisk minus 8 hours to the current time. That's going to be the most recent 8 hours. That's the default. Also, you can choose what type of timestamp you show. I actually prefer the partial timestamp. It gives me a little bit more detail. The full timestamp will show you the day, month, year, hour, minute, second. So I'm going to go with the partial here. Now some of these other things, these are all fairly straightforward. Display format allows us to specify whether we want to see a grid or not. And the preview kind of tells the tale here. So for example, the tag names. Do you want the tag names to appear or not? As you can see over here, that's going to help you figure out how this is going to look. Now, over here, you get to choose what orientation we're going to use. Normally, it's going to be the left to right, but you can also do vertical trends going up to down or down to up, etc. I'll go ahead and choose that. This right here allows you to turn on and off this plot title that you see right there. And I think I'll go ahead and keep that on for right now. And a very important one to mention here is this markers option. Now watch what happens in the sample when I choose markers. It shows us, we have a lot more markers than just the three we normally see. Now we call these three that normally appear the colorblind markers. They normally appear three per trace, and they're there simply for those folks that may be colorblind or if you're printing to a monochrome device. As you can see, you can map the colors here and the actual icons here, this diamond, this circle, this filled circle, etc. You can match that to the appropriate name of the tag. And so if you do not choose markers, what you will see is just three markers per trace simply for distinguishing one trace from another. Now compare that to selecting markers. When you choose markers for real, what you end up with is you show one marker for each archive value in that trace. So it's really a way of indicating every single time there's a value that's actually been stored in the archive for that trace. So we'll take a look at the before and after on this in just a second. A trace format gives us an option to, or all the different options for changing pen colors. For example, I don't particularly like the bright green. I'd rather go with some colors, something found in nature maybe, something a little easier on the eyes. And you'll get some warnings if you have any duplicates. I think I may have, no, I don't think I've got any duplicates here. But you can see this is my pen 1, 2, and 3. And this is also where you can choose things like the background color. You may see people with different background colors. This is where they would do that. And then finally, layout is rarely used. It's used if in the event that you've decided to use this new plot option to generate more than one trend at a time. If I do choose new plot, what we end up with is now we've got, in addition to plot 0, we've got a plot 1. And now I can choose what the layout will be. Is it 2 rows by 1 column? 1 row by 2 columns? Or how do you want to generate this? Actually, I'm not really interested in doing that. I don't find a lot of people using this right from the start. It's more of an advanced feature to generate a lot of traces at once, all of the same size and shape. And you can go ahead and specify the, the number of rows across. And then you can have extra columns and rows at the top and bottom to get some, really flexible formatting if you're interested in generating many plots at once. I find more people simply just create the plots they need one at a time. I'm going to go ahead and delete that plot. I don't need that. Okay, now that I'm done with the configuration, let's go ahead and say OK. We'll take a look at the what this looks like. So you can see, I've turned that markers on, and with markers on, we're getting a value, or a little marker at each time there's a value in the archive. That's not the default. Normally, the markers is turned off. So we would normally only see three per plot. That's the so-called colorblind markers. Now the other thing that's a little different on this is I had turned off the grid. So normally by default you'll see the grid turned on. Now all of these things can be, you can choose your preferences as to how you actually, what the defaults actually are. If you go into Tools, Preferences, Trend, you can actually set these defaults. So if you want some different timestamp as a default or some different marker behavior or different grid behavior, you can do that. Now a couple of other points to make. Notice the partial timestamp down here, 3, 4, 5, etc. Yeah, that partial timestamp will change as I make this bigger. There we go. Yeah, that's a little different. As I said, you have the option, where is that? In here to do that full or partial. Here's the full timestamp. You can even make it relative. It's going to be relative from the current time, or the end time, I should say. So this is going back 7 hours, for example. Let me go ahead and set this back to the full timestamp. By the way, notice here we've got the plot title. It ends up defaulting to plot 0. To change that, I'll just go in here and modify this, call it, let's say it's just a test for training. And that now becomes my plot title.